Thank you. And thank you so much for having us today. We have a fabulous conversation planned for you. I'm joined by David Cote, who's one of the most respected CEOs and business leaders in America, former CEO of Honeywell for 15 years, just wrote a book, which we're going to talk about as well, called Winning Now, Winning Later. And I don't often endorse business books or even like business books, but I will tell you genuinely without pandering, this is very much worth reading. And I scribbled lots of notes to myself selfishly with lots of tips and things about how maybe I can be better. So I recommend it. But David's here. David is the executive chairman of Vertiv Holdings. And David, thanks for coming.
Well, thank you. And thank you for that commentary. It really did try to write something that would be different. So nice to know it's had that effect.
It has. And I think especially for this audience, I should also say I was once a term member, now a full-time member proudly, but we have a lot of term members obviously on this call. And so there's a lot of lessons embedded here, and we'll talk about them over the next half hour all together. And then we're going to open it up and then make this as interactive as possible. So if you have questions, by all means, we do want you to jump in, and we'll start questions probably in about 25 minutes from now. But David, why don't we start with this, just lay of the land as somebody who lived in the middle of the corporate world for as long as you have, and looking out at the economy that we are all grappling with, and as sort of a dual crisis, it appears, taking place in our country between COVID and real questions about inequality and systemic racism and all of these issues that all seem to be bubbling up at the same time. How you're thinking about those things now, but also really how you think business, to the extent that business can play a role in all of this, should be thinking about it.
Well, business has to think about all of this. I think a lot of business people would like to just be able to say, I'm just going to focus on my business and that's it. I'm going to ignore everything that's happening out there around me. That's just not possible. I don't know that it was ever possible, but for sure it's not possible now. So every business person, as they start figuring out how to run their business, has to be considering everything you just mentioned and trying to sort out what's the right way to help and to participate. But at the same time, don't lose sight that their primary responsibility is to run the company and to not forget their investors.
Let me ask you about that, because we are living at a moment where the role and responsibility of business and capitalism is being questioned. We watched the Business Roundtable just last year announce really a redefinition or redefining of the way they think about their constituents, if you will. That shareholders are no longer the primal seat at the table, that employees and clients and customers in the community now need to not just need to be considered, but if you read that, need to be considered almost as equals. And how you think about that in this moment, and I ask in part because you do see CEOs and businesses being either asked to step up or stepping up themselves into the political arena and into the community in ways that they haven't before.
Well, I guess a couple of ways to address that. The first is understanding what the role of a business is in a society. And business is the primary source of standard of living, because that's where productivity comes from. And I think at least 95% of economists will agree that productivity is what drives standard of living. Productivity comes from businesses. A government can enable it with infrastructure, education, et cetera, but it has to come from business. So you don't want to burden businesses with becoming social institutions. They still need to think about, okay, how do I become more productive so that I can grow my sales, have new products and services, and do the right thing for my investors? So we don't want to lose sight of that. When I was at Honeywell, and yes, obviously we have a great story. We took market capitalization from $20 billion to $120 billion. But at the same time, we invested $10 billion in fixing all of the environmental issues that a 100-year-old chemical company has, spent $3.5 billion doing that. We spent a couple of billion dollars to start resolving all the asbestos suits we had. And we invested over $5 billion into our pension plan to make sure that we went from an underfunded problem fund to one that was overfunded and could support our pensioners. So these two things are not mutually exclusive. And I always looked at it as, yes, I was focused on the share owner. I wanted to do the right thing for the share owner. But that doesn't mean that you ignore every other constituency. You still got to think about your employees, your community, your customers, government, all of that. You don't want to lose sight of that. I've been a little, when I first saw the BRT statement, I thought, oh, okay, well, that's no big deal, really, because any CEO who ran their company right was thinking about everybody, all while trying to figure out how to do the right thing for the owner. But it seems to have gotten a little carried away to the point where the share owner is not even primary. I think they're kind of behind now. And I think that's a mistake for our society if we do that.
Okay, so I'll give you, and maybe it's not going to be a difficult question for you, but it was a difficult question that I know another CEO has been grappling with. So you have a major Fortune 500 company, publicly traded company, someone who signed the BRT statement in good faith and wants to live up to it, now has a challenged business in the midst of COVID-19, and is also a company that distributes a dividend. And I had a conversation with this individual earlier this week, and the debate was, do I get rid of the dividend or lower the dividend, or do I lay off employees? Now, maybe I'll try to bring some of those employees back later, I don't know, but who is the compact with? I think this individual felt that he had a specific compact with shareholders insofar as they're people who bought the stock because of the dividend, pensioners and the like. So he thinks there's a commitment made there, but also thinks, especially now that he signed this BRT statement, and I think he genuinely loves his employees, thinks, well, if I get rid of the employees and this happens and I don't get rid of the dividend, then I'm going to be called a hypocrite.
Well, he'll probably be called a hypocrite by somebody in that kind of Hobson's choice there, because when you run into times like this, you generally have two options. Both of them are unimpressive, and your job is to really choose the least bad. So in this case, I don't know enough about the company or the circumstances to come up with other solutions. But I would say you need to look at what's my permanent outlook look like for the company. And if I lay off a bunch of employees and I still cut the dividend 2 years later, that's probably not so smart. If I look at my employees, is there a different way to do it? Can I furlough them so that they still have jobs and medical benefits, but they can still get unemployment, and that can carry us for a while. But in my view, the primary contract is with the share owner. So my leaning would be to say, okay, find a way to preserve your dividend. You can't forget the share owner in all this and the viability of your company, especially if you're trying to drive that productivity that's necessary for society.
So here's a policy question. And here we are, Council on Foreign Relations. It looks like CEOs have been either pushed or are pushing themselves into the policy and political debate in ways that they never had before, right? You see Tim Cook out just yesterday with comments on the immigration policy issue. That might be a natural for him. But of course, he was also trying to work with the president and the administration to keep the relations between the US and China intact, because that's so crucial to his business as well. And so, and he's also been an advocate on LGBT issues, which therefore in certain cases puts him at odds with the administration. And you're seeing this over and over and over again. And I'm curious what you think has led to this. Is this a particular moment in business? Is this a void of leadership or something else taking place in Washington? What's created this moment, and what should the role of these executives be?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I don't know that I have a good answer on how did we get here at this point. My guess is seeds of a lot of this were planted in the Great Recession and the aftermath of that, and then having to run into what we are now. In terms of what the CEO role should be, every CEO needs to make their own decision here. So, because some are going to be comfortable with it, some aren't. It's one where I would tread carefully if I were a CEO, because at the end of the day, you want your company to perform. If you're taking a position on something where it's 50-50 amongst all your employees, why do you want to alienate half your people, even though you may believe something? And there's nothing wrong with advocating privately and supporting privately with your own money elsewhere. But to use the company to do it, I'm not sure is always a good decision. There are things where it does make sense for company CEOs to participate. So, for example, trying to facilitate better relationships with the US and China, absolutely. I don't think you're going to find a single CEO who says something like, oh yeah, racism is okay. They're not going to say that, because nobody, in my view, at least every CEO I've ever dealt with, they don't believe that. And they really are trying to do the right thing. And most are trying to understand, okay, exactly what is it? Because I don't know that I always see it. Help me see it. Help me figure out how to do it. Those are all perfectly legitimate things to be doing.
Right. What do you do? I mean, the environment, I don't know if the environment's changed or not, but it feels like part of it is pressure from employees. Employees seem to have a bigger voice than they've ever had before. Maybe that's a function of social media. And so here we are on so many different, what might be described as historically social issues that we would talk about, where you have people internally saying, I need you to step up and speak out, or customers saying, I want you to speak out. And this goes back to the issue of, in a world that's so polarized, how do you do that and do it successfully and either thread a needle, or do you just stake out a position?
Well, that's why I would hate to give any advice to any CEO saying this is how you do it, because I really think this is going to be an individual choice. Depending on the ownership, the CEO, how employees right. feel about things, everybody's situation is going to be different. So I'd feel uncomfortable ever telling anybody, oh yeah, no matter who you are, this is what right. you have to go do.
Let me ask you, in the wake of the killing of George Floyd, there's a lot of self-reflection, as you might imagine, inside boardrooms across the country about hiring and more diversity and how to do it. And, in the instance of Honeywell, maybe you can speak to sort of some of the hiring practices, what you think the best practice is supposed to be. Do you believe in things like the Rooney Rule, where you have to have a diversity candidate for every single position at a minimum? That's something. And then how do you weigh the different components of candidates, especially in this type of environment? And look, these are sensitive conversations. I'm a white guy in my 40s. You're white as well, so I understand how these can be difficult conversations, but they're happening, I think, across the country. I wouldn't say in the corner office anymore, in the virtual corner office of businesses everywhere. And I think people are trying to grapple with it. So what do you think?
Well, first of all, I have to caveat all of this with, not only am I white, but I'm old, I'm a former CEO, and I'm from New Hampshire. So it's not like I have tremendous experience with understanding the adversity that racism causes. What I can say, though, is that a lot of these concepts we employed at Honeywell when I first got there, and not a lot of them worked. There's a lot of kind of high-minded stuff, and everybody's going to do things in a very general sense, and people like hearing that. But one of the things that bothered me at Honeywell is, like, my first 6 years there, because we tracked it, we discussed it, we did a lot of this stuff. And we'd find our representation would increase 1 year, come down the next, increase the next, come down the next. And 6 years into it, we were in the same place we were when we started. And there were two things we did that made a difference. The first was, this tends to be much more of an issue that needs to be addressed locally, not nationally. So if you've got a company with 50 locations and you just look at it on a national basis, you're not going to get the same kind of answer as you do if you look at plants and businesses locally, which is where they tend to hire. So we actually did a fair amount of work. Some would call it AI. I think I'd say it's more like just really understanding local statistics. And if we could find good local schools where, say, the number of Black graduates were 30% of their population, we would talk to the business about, well, why don't you hire here and at least be at 30%? And we would start to look at that regularly. And that, combined with the second item, which was twice annually, we met as a staff, and each business had to show all the hiring they did and all the attrition they did. And all the hiring had to have a representation rate greater than their average overall. And the attrition rate had to have a lower rate than what they were overall. And having to report out to everybody else on the team every 6 months, nobody wants to be embarrassed and say they didn't do anything or nothing happened. And for the first time, for about 10 years running now, our representation increases every year. And it was only by doing things like that that made it a lot more specific rather than kind of high-minded discussion that made a difference.
Right. I want to pivot the conversation a bit to the book because I really did enjoy it. And it gives us an opportunity to talk a little bit about your story and maybe weave in some of them into the context of what we're talking about right now. You know, we have a lot of young people, as we said on this call, listening to you. And one of the things you wrote was that when you were young, you said you were, quote, lazy, immature, and directionless. And, you know, I think
some people would maintain the middle one is still true.
Well, you know, a lot of people are always trying to find their passion. You talk a lot. I mean, I feel blessed in that I feel like I had a passion just since I was a kid. I wanted to be in the business I'm in now, having these conversations with you. But how do you think you found your way?
Oh, I had an epiphany. It was, I was an hourly employee. I'd finished 3 years of college and quit again to be a commercial fisherman, which didn't work out so well. And I was just running a punch press nights in a factory. And my wife was a nurse, and we lived in a third floor, unheated, uninsulated apartment in New Hampshire. So yes, it'd be chilly in the winter. And all of a sudden she came home and told me she was pregnant and that she couldn't work anymore. And I did the analysis and did some budgeting and found out I was spending $2 a week more than I was making. And I had $100 in the bank, and I said, okay, I got 50 weeks to figure out what the hell I'm going to do. And all I could think of was my kid's going to die because I'm a screw off. And I have never been so scared in my life as I was when I realized all of a sudden three people were going to be counting on me and I couldn't just do whatever I wanted like I used to. And I can remember when he was born in February, I taped up all the windows with masking tape because the wind was coming through. And I still tell him today that he's the reason I'm successful because he scared the bejesus out of me.
So tell us, though, a little bit about the Honeywell story. In particular, I'm curious because a lot of people, especially early on in mid-career, are always trying to figure out how to become a great manager. A great manager of other people. It's one thing to be a talent on your own. It's another to manage other people. And when you think you, I don't know if there's a moment at which you think you cracked that code.
Well, I'd have to say it's been a lifelong learning experience. And I can remember when I went from TRW to Honeywell and an analyst asked me, geez, you know, you had 75,000 people at TRW. Now you're going to have 115,000. How are you going to manage that increase? And I told him to his disgust, but it was absolutely true. Said, look, going from 75,000 to 115,000 is not that big a deal. I didn't know all of the 75,000. I'm not going to know all the 115,000. The toughest transition for me was when I was an individual contributor and all of a sudden I had three people working for me. Because that's the first time you start to face, oh, I have to trust other people. To what extent do I trust other people? How do I learn to delegate but not abdicate? How do I learn to delegate but not micromanage? How do I treat people differently? And I'd have to say it's been a lifelong learning experience for me, starting with that first job.
How many people do you think you can reasonably manage? There's a question about an org chart. And the reason I ask the question is because people often think how many people can conceivably report to one other person. You know, there's a running joke that if you have under 10 people working for you, they work for you. If it's over 10 people, you work for them.
Well, you'll be pleased to hear me say, I would put it somewhere in that 10 to 15 range. You could probably go to 17 and still be fine, maybe 20, I guess. But once you start to get up there, I think it gets really difficult to really have a handle on everything that's going on. The thing I would say is the thing that does make a big difference is if you have really good people with whom you can have really good discussions, give and take, to arrive at what's the right strategy, how are you going to measure, are you making progress in that direction? All of that gets a lot easier. And I could say by the time I left Honeywell, for example, I had just an outstanding group of people. And it was relatively easy to have all those kinds of discussions and agreement. And I think I had 13 direct reports at that point.
Okay, so here's a question that may be actually relevant to a lot of people on the phone right now. How do you manage remotely? And the reason I ask is you traveled a lot when you were running the company.
Yeah.
And actually most CEOs today, especially of large corporations, are living on an airplane. And so you have to figure out a way effectively to manage from the air, or at least virtually. Not that different from today. You know, do you have any thoughts?
Well, that is correct. And for example, of my, say, 13 direct reports, I think only five of them were at the headquarters with me, because everybody else is running businesses, dispersed functions. So they were never all together anyway. As much as people may curse email, I absolutely love it. And I found, to your point, I'd spend 500-600 hours a year on the plane, which is like 23 days a year, 24 hours a day on the plane, to get out there to find out what's going on, meet with customers, visit plants, meet with employees, get a sense for what's going on. But it's still pretty easy to be connected. I worry a little bit that the working from home discussion is getting a little carried away. And there's just something about human beings, human nature, that I think is facilitated by people being able to be together and bump into each other, talk, ideas come up, conversations are easier. And I think this kind of run to working from home is a little overstated at this point. It's not to say that it can't be useful, but in general, I think human beings are better served by being able to be together and just talk, converse, trade ideas, jokes. I mean, I'm sure if you've been on a conference call with 10 people and somebody's tried to joke about something and they all fall flat. You just don't get that normal human interaction.
Yep. We're going to open it up for questions in just a couple of minutes. I have a couple of quick ones for you. Maybe we'll do this almost rapid fire. One of the things you talk about in the book is this idea of trying to think short-term and long-term at the same time. Two ideas that ultimately, in many ways, at least from the outside, look like they're at odds. How do you do it?
Well, there's a lot to talk about there. And for me, this goes back to a fundamental that I talk about a lot and do in the book about success is about achieving two seemingly conflicting things at the same time. And as human beings, human nature, people want you to pick one. Okay, boss, what's the one thing you want me to do? But it's never just one thing. There's always something else you have to accomplish at the same time that's conflicting. So some examples, do you want low inventory or do you want great customer delivery? Do you want high prices and margin rates or do you want big volumes? Do you want people closest to the action empowered to make quick decisions or do you want good control so nothing bad happens? Do you want good short-term results or do you want good long-term results? In every case, you need to accomplish both. And I think it's true, not just in business, but in society. And as you and I have talked about before, when we talk about addressing racism, for example, There's the short-term issues that we should address, of course, like criminal justice reform, policing tactics, hiring, all that needs to be addressed. But there's a long-term issue we should be thinking about also, and that's education. Because if we look at how we fund education, the difference in public education across the U.S., we've got a system that perpetuates class distinctions. And if you want to perpetuate inequality, that's a great way to do it. Keep funding it the way we have in the past. We ought to think about how do we do something differently so that 20 years from now, we're in a very different situation than we are today.
Two other questions, and I promise we will open it up. And one may require a longer answer. So let me go here because we haven't talked about it yet. Manufacturing in America and the ability of bringing things back to this country and what the lessons of this COVID-19 situation really are about resiliency, about this idea of just-in-time supply chains, frankly, even about PPP and the like, and things that we should be able to make here. How do you think this changes the world?
Well, I'd break that into two separate points, I think. The first one is, I've got to admit, this may not be the nicest way to say it, but whenever I see that somebody's bragging about bringing a bunch of jobs back to the U.S., say, well, really, you're kind of spending dumb money twice. If it should have been here, you shouldn't have moved it in the first place, and it might not have been the smartest thing to do. We always tried to, both at Honeywell and at Vertiv, to be more what we called pole-focused. So if you're selling in the Pacific, produce in the Pacific, in Europe for Europe, in the Americas for Americas, and I think that gets you to a much better and different spot. The second one is going to change, and that's that I think everybody started to realize that supply chains were a little less robust than we might have thought. And a lot of companies ended up with a single source of supply in, say, a low-cost country that all of a sudden closed them off completely. And there's things that we're going to need to make sure that as countries, we can produce internally, whether it's masks, ventilators, vaccines, I mean, whatever it is that we think is going to be important. There's things companies are going to need to look at to say, how do I make sure my supply chain is more robust so that if a country does run into a problem, I don't find that I've got two suppliers, but they're both in the same country dealing with the same issue. The third one would be more of a caution to say those first two can end up being used as an excuse for protectionism, which I think would be a gross mistake. And we need to, make sure there's surety of supply chain, that we can get the kind of medical support that we need when we need it. But we've got to be very careful we don't drift over into protectionism and all of a sudden everything becomes critical because not everything is.
On that same subject, what do you think about the relationship with China? Since we are here at the Council on Foreign Relations, what do you think should happen?
Well, first of all, I don't think as a country we have a strategy for how to deal with China in the 21st century. And in my view, China is the biggest geopolitical issue we're going to deal with in the 21st century. And it's a lot more complicated than anything that we ever dealt with with the Soviet Union. It's not going to be as simple as that. We've got a lot of point-to-point discussions, some angry left and right, but there is no U.S. strategy for how do you deal with China other than people saying suppress them, leave them alone. None of those make sense. We need something more thoughtful than that. Both the U.S. and China are going to have to figure out how do we grow together peacefully in this century. And that means figuring out the territorial issues, the political issues. What do you do with students? There's probably eight other things that people can mention. My view is it's a mistake for us not to try to engage China. And we need to recognize the way I've described it is they're a steroidal teenager. They haven't had much experience with having to deal with the whole rest of the world. Most of the time they were insular. They've grown very fast. They've grown strong very fast. I don't think they really recognize their own strength or how to use it. And interestingly, what seems to be happening now is how China is acting is bringing all of our allies together in a way that we have been unable to in the U.S. at this point. And that I think leaves opportunity for the U.S. and China to figure out how to work better together in this century.
And then my final question, and then we'll definitely open it up, relates to taxes. You and I have had conversations about taxes forever, corporate taxes. And we had debates and arguments about whether to lower the tax rate and how to make the tax rate more competitive in the United States. And that happened just a couple of years ago, and the rate came down. And I wonder whether the pandemic and the fact that the U.S. government has effectively provided insurance, I mean, sort of the ultimate corporate insurance, you know, we're running almost a corporate welfare program at this point, whether you think it's going to change the dynamic around taxes in America when this is all over, both for companies and individuals, and how you think companies and shareholders and investors, and from a policy perspective, we should all think about that.
Well, it's going to be a bigger question than just taxes. The question has not changed from 10 years ago when I was one of President Obama's appointees to the Simpson-Bowles Commission. Yep. At least back then, politicians did not understand the magnitude of the problem or where it was going. Now they understand it, but have chosen to ignore it. And everybody is just going to wait for the crisis. And it still involves the same two things that it did from the very beginning 10 years ago. We have to address the spending side. And Medicare and Medicaid spending are swamping the system. They've known for 25 years at this point that this was coming because it's a demographic push. It's my generation that's going to continue to crush the spending here. Everybody's known it's coming. It's going to continue to rise, and we have a very ineffective, inefficient system there. Coincident with that, you've got the need for taxes and the overall take on tax revenue, which has historically been in the 19 to 20% of GDP range, is down to something like 17% now. I supported the move on the corporate side because companies need to be competitive globally. That does not mean that there's no other way to raise taxes overall. And that grand bargain that we were talking about 10 years ago that has a tax increase and spending reductions, a different way of doing Medicare and Medicaid, still has to come together. I think there's a very good chance that nothing comes together and we decide that either we're going to float through this thing and the crisis never happens and all us boomers die and spending goes down and it all fixes itself, which it would, that is possible. Or there's a crisis, and then you have the discussion and blame all your predecessors for the problem and figure out what you're going to do. But unfortunately, that's a miserable way to deal with the problem. As I used to say, democracy is uniquely suited to putting up the traffic light after the third accident.
Well, let's hope we don't wait for that accident. But on that lovely note, I want to thank you for the conversation. I know there's lots of questions that are awaiting you, and I'm going to turn it back to the audience now.
Well, it's always fun talking to you, Andrew, I got to say.
Always a ball.
Ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder to ask a question, please click on the raise hand icon on your Zoom window. When you are called on, please accept the unmute now button and proceed with your name, affiliation, and question. We will take the first question from Miriam Safi.
Thank you. Miriam Safi with the State Department. You talked about Honeywell collecting data on diversity every 6 months to sort of more tangibly measure progress around representation. And the teams that were successful in recruiting and retaining diverse employees, what were best practices that and sort of your reflections? Thanks.
Well, this is one where I let each business do what they got behind. And buy-in matters a lot. So I felt like if I told them, this is how I want you to go do it, you get what I used to, what I call, and I mentioned in the book, compliance with words rather than compliance with intent. And you can say something like, gee, I want you to have a diverse candidate on every slate. And I can say my wife worked in a company that imposed that. And all of a sudden she had all her friends coming to her and saying, would you please be on this slate and interview with me? Because I can't find somebody and I need to satisfy this condition. So people find a way around it. And I found the only thing that really worked, again, was to say, you're going to be measured on the result. And we still, I don't want any of this. Well, you know, we can't find the people. We can't find qualified people. Said, with given the numbers of people we hire and given the overall population, I refuse to accept that. So I expect you to find a way. And as a result of that, each business, each function did it differently. They might go to different schools to recruit. They might decide that they were going to do that with slates, but make sure that they had real bona fide candidates there. And as a result of that, we got somewhere. But I tried very hard not to impose, this is how you will do it.
Our next question comes from Andres Small.
Hi, thank you very much. Andres Small from Partners Group. And my question is about the duality and the tension you were speaking about. And I like that. And I wonder if you can extend it to being an operator at Honeywell versus being an owner, acquirer at GS Acquisition and now Vertiv. What tension do you find between being an operator versus being an owner that both need to win but collide the most?
Yeah, actually, I have to say, I haven't seen a dichotomy there. It's you run into the exact same things. Now I'm, as you know, a part owner of a company called Vertiv Holdings, a data center products company. And we run into the same things there. And how do we generate short-term results that are good enough, but at the same time, generate the funding we need for long-term investments? And we go through the same discussions there on everything, on reducing staff costs, for example, if you're looking at finance, HR, legal, IT, and say, I expect costs to go down. Well, what's the first thing they start to say is, oh, okay, well, we'll have to decrease service levels. You go, no, I expect costs to go down. I expect you to increase service levels and to ascertain what they are via an anonymous survey. So your job is to get both of those done. So that hasn't changed for me, unless you've got to see the question differently. For me, it was there's no difference there.
David, can I just follow up on that for a second? Because it's an interesting thing, and I don't know if you can explore this a little bit more. I'm curious, being an investor, when, you know, this latest endeavor for you, how you think it changed your mindset? Was it different?
Changed my mindset regarding what?
Well, I just wonder look, you had a stake in Honeywell. I mean, this is sort of a compensation question to some degree. What it feels like to be an owner versus the operator. It's a bit of the question you got before, but in terms of just, do you think it changed anything for you in a different way?
No, not so far. I was a pretty good-sized owner of Honeywell also, as you probably
know. Right, no, I know. That's why.
Yeah, so I always looked at stuff, and I think it's important for CEOs to think about a business this way, is if you owned it, what would you be doing differently? And if you look at it as an owner, then you start to act differently. You start figuring out, okay, I got to generate those short-term results that everybody complains about the market wants. But you also start to focus on how do you do the right stuff for the long-term. And I can remember, God, I think it was first or second year at Honeywell, bankers would come to me saying, geez, why don't you do an LBO of Honeywell? And I'd say, okay, well, I'm sure I'd have to make the argument to the board and to investors about why this is good for share owners. What would I tell them? And they said, well, you'd run the company differently. said, well, like how? I said, well, you'd cut corporate. I said, well, I am cutting corporate. I'm already doing that. I said, I just wouldn't feel right about going to them and saying I'd do something differently when if there's something I would do different as an owner, well, I should be doing it now. I shouldn't wait until I own it. So I didn't really see the difference there if you're approaching your CEO job as if I'm an owner.
Did you? Okay, but now if you had, do you have a preference? If you could do it again, is there a model that's better? That, you know, there seems to be a real movement to say that you just look at how few public companies there are relative to private companies over the last 2 decades, 3 decades. Do you say to yourself now that you've experienced both that one actually is better?
Oh, I still think that some kind of ownership for a CEO, for a leader, and I'm a big fan of options despite kind of some of the agencies not liking it. I like that the kind of ownership where if the company becomes a lot more valuable, the CEO can do very well. If the company doesn't become more valuable, the CEO doesn't get anything. And it's one of the reasons why I never took restricted shares, I think one time early on, but I did not take restricted shares and I did not encourage it even for my own people because it protects your downside. And even if a company does poorly, you still have something. I always wanted people to know if the company doesn't do well, you'll get nothing. So we need to make sure we do well here. And it just caused us to act very differently.
I think there's another question.
Our next question comes from Seema Modi.
David, good afternoon. Seema Modi, global markets reporter at CNBC and also a term member at CFR. It's been an unprecedented year, the pandemic, companies having to take on extraordinary measures by raising debt, and then the conversation elevated around racial injustice, companies trying to figure out their path forward. I'm curious, you know, what your top advice, given your seasoned experience, on how to maintain culture. How do you really embrace strong culture and bring employees together at a time when companies are going through sort of this extraordinary time, and also to mention working from home?
Well, I am, you hit one of my topic hot buttons because I'm a big fan of culture. And I know there are people who get considered culture vultures sometimes because they may talk about it too much or just want to consult on it. But I do believe, and I've said it from the beginning, that sustainability of performance comes from culture. And there's a number of ways to do it. The first thing you got to do is talk about it so that people understand what it is you're trying to do. And that's where you talk about the importance of performance, of self-awareness. How do you focus on the customer? How do you make sure you do the right thing for diversity? How do you make teamwork work? What do you stand for environmentally? You have to talk about all that stuff. The short term and long term that we talked about, you have to talk about all of it. But then the next really big step is you have to walk the talk. And just like the parents who say, do as I say, not as I do, it's the same thing in companies. If they see the boss acting a certain way, different from how he or she talks about it, then they're going to comply with the actions they see. So if you're talking about short term, at the same time you're trying to do long term, if they see you taking accounting transactions or distributor loading to make a short term number, cutting long term growth programs, that's the behavior you're going to get. So you've got to do all that kind of work and have that kind of discussion so that when you get into a tough time, you've got something that can start to bring people together, that they do have that culture. The biggest thing you can provide people when you are in a tough time like this is hope. You can't promise them an answer that says, I guarantee you this is going to end by such and such a date. I can guarantee you this is when this crisis ends. You can't do that because you don't know. And a line I used to use a lot was to say, the one thing I do know is that no one else does know. And as a result of that, you have to frame your answers differently. Don't give people answers that you can't be confident are going to happen. The thing you can tell them is, here's the things that we're doing so that when we come out of this, we're going to be stronger than ever, meaning that your jobs are going to be have a greater chance of being intact, and that we're going to do all the right things, and things will get better. I can't tell you when, but they will. Now, it doesn't mean it makes everybody happy and they go back and have a party saying, oh man, we don't have to worry. But it's the sort of thing that adds to your culture over time when they see that things do happen that way. And I got a great perspective on this when we chose to do furloughs in the last recession rather than layoffs. It was, nobody was doing that. We were the only big company that approached it that way. Yes, I got complaints from people saying stuff like, for God's sakes, just lay off 10% of us. I can't continue to live on 10% less money. When we came out of the recession, and because we came out of it as well as we did, I got an unbelievable number of thank you notes from people saying, thank you for the way you handled this. I feel better about myself. I'm glad we did it that way. So I wouldn't say you can preserve a happy culture when times are tough, but what you can do is build on, be able to use some of what you created and create the dynamics for an even stronger culture coming out.
Ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder, to ask a question, please click the raise hand icon on your window.
Can I just follow up on, can I follow up on Seema's question for a second? I have a culture question, which Seema's a colleague, so thank you for asking the question. But my follow-up, David, is the following. I think there's a debate within the business community about how to do culture. And the reason I say it is there are some people who think that they should just lead by example, it's a role model story, but not to talk about culture. It doesn't need to be overt. It's something we do that's built into what we do, but it's not, it doesn't require an overt intentional act, let's just suggest. And then there are other business leaders who say, you know what, this actually has to be very intentional. It has to be so intentional that we have to do meetings and retreats and other things to create the culture beyond just modeling it out for other people because that unto itself is not enough. And I've heard both sides. I've heard people who think you have to talk about culture, debate with people who say that they're wasting their time, and the other people who say you can't really do it the other way. What do you think?
Well, getting back to what we're talking at the beginning of this one is, I do think you need to explain what you want the culture to be. I have little tolerance for those offsite meetings to talk about culture and how we're going to do it and what's our morale building program. And man, I think those things are ridiculous. And I can remember having a boss who thought this was great stuff, and we spent a weekend together, and he brought in some guru who had us all sit around, and we had to close our eyes and imagine ourselves in an imaginary bubble that took off out of the room and looking around. And as you might imagine, all my buddies and I were, you know, kind of picking up our head a little bit to see if everybody else was doing it, and then giggling with each other, like, can you believe the stupid stuff we're doing right now? That puts culture backwards, not forward. What you do need to do, though, I think, is, given how differently people learn, some people like to hear it, some people like to see it, some people need to see the combination. And I think by being able to take the time with your staff, and we did this in a day, to come up with what do we want our culture to be, and then I spent the next 16 years acting that way so people can see you walk the talk. That's what makes it happen.
Okay, thanks. I think we have another question.
Our next question will come from Chloe Dymarofsky.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi. Thank you so much for this. This has been incredibly inspiring to me. I'm the president and CEO of Disaster Recovery Institute International. So my question relates.
Thank God, I thought you were going to tell me you were a culture consultant, and I was going to hide under my table.
No, absolutely not. Although I was curious how that might impact some people who might be. but no, we have never done any of those offsites. So I think I'm in agreement with you on that. We take people out to dinner, and you know, then they can build their own culture. So my question relates to the H-1B visa restriction that has just come out, and how do you think that will impact American jobs, the future of employment in the U.S., and generally our competitiveness?
Wow, taking it back a step, I am a big believer that if we want the strongest, most vibrant economy in the world, and we look at that and say, that's important because it generates the resources we need to do to support all the things that we want to accomplish. And it affects our standing in the world if we took an approach from a CFR perspective to show our system works best, then we want the most ambitious, smartest, people in the world coming here. And we ought to be doing everything we can to encourage smart people, assertive people, aggressive people who want to make a difference, who want to get somewhere. I mean, anybody who came here as part of a immigrant family at some point, it's because they had some guts and were willing to do something different and take a chance. And man, I just think it's a shame if we don't allow people like that into the country so that we as a society benefit from all their capability. We should want as many smart, aggressive, assertive people as we can get. And it's not a case where economics is a zero-sum game where, wait, that gives us more smart people to spread the wealth over. What it really does is it creates more new wealth. And I just think we ought to be encouraging smart immigration everywhere we can.
David, on that note, we want to thank you for a fabulous conversation.
Well, it was fun for me. I enjoyed it. I hope it worked.
I enjoyed it. This has been a ball. We want to also thank everybody who's been watching. And for those who ask questions, we are greatly appreciative. And I hope to see you. I hope to see you in the future in person, my friend.
That will happen, I promise, as soon as we can travel again.
Okay. Cross your fingers. Cross your fingers. I'm going to hand it back to the good folks at CFR.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, you are welcome to disconnect from this virtual meeting. Thank you so much for attending.